Dr. C. Webster Pearson, your host for Health Matters. Our purpose is to assist you in managing your health care by providing you balanced information and resources to help you make knowledgeable choices about your health. Our subject for today's show is opioids and what you need to know about them. It is not uncommon to see stories every day in the news about the opioid crisis. According to the Department of Health and Human Services, on average, 130 plus Americans die each day from opioid-related drug overdoses. This accounts for two-thirds of all overdose deaths. And because of rising opioids overdoses and deaths, the White House and the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services have declared the opioid an epidemic and a public health emergency. Now, pharmacists can be the first line of defense for patients who have been prescribed an opioid for pain management. They have a unique knowledge about the safe and effective use of medications and about the adverse effects that can come from inappropriate use. This knowledge enables pharmacists to play an important role in patients' understanding about opioids. They can also play an important role in opioid drug abuse prevention, education, and assistance. And joining me on this edition of Health Matters to talk about opioids and what you need to know about them to keep your home and your family safe is my guest, Dr. Michelle Harbour. Dr. Harbour is a pharmacist in Northern Virginia. And in addition to filling prescriptions, she provides flu, pneumonia, hepatitis A and B, tetanus, shingles, and MMR, which is measles, mumps, and rubella immunizations. She has provided flu shots for local businesses and churches, and she also provides medication therapy management, or MTM, to Medicare Part D patients, which consists of reviewing patients' list of medications, making sure that they know what the medications are for and how to take them, and whether they have any symptoms indicating a side effect from those medications. She also consults with the patient's doctors if there are problems that need to be addressed with the medications that have been prescribed. Dr. Harbour is a graduate from the Medical College of Virginia at Virginia Commonwealth University in 2002, and she has been a licensed and practicing pharmacist for 16 years. Dr. Harbour, welcome to Health Matters.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. And again, I always go back to my old statement about being a nurse. Being a nurse, I know that pharmacists are a very important part of the healthcare team. And unfortunately, they're one that many patients don't get to see very often in hospital while they see you frequently in the community. So welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
And this is a very important topic that we're talking about today, and a national one of concern. Because as I stated earlier, opioids are one of these necessary evils in our society, and especially for patients who have very painful and debilitating diseases. But in the hands of the wrong people and for the wrong reasons, they can be deadly. So let's just start out talking a little bit about what it means to be addicted to an opioid.
Okay. So to become addicted to an opioid, you always have your illegal opioids, such as heroin. Mm-hmm. But people don't realize that you can also become dependent upon your prescription pain medication. Mm-hmm. Let's say you were in a car accident, mm-hmm. and you're in excruciating pain. So mm-hmm. they prescribe you an opioid painkiller. Mm-hmm. And so you take it because you don't want to feel this pain.
Right.
And so you take it every day, and then you run out. And then you need more of it. Oh goodness, I'm still in more pain. Mm-hmm. So you go see your doctor and you get more. Mm-hmm. So this cycle causes your body to need this medication to stop that pain.
Right.
And so this is the beginning of addiction or dependence upon this medication.
Right.
And it happens, it can happen to anyone, especially when you least expect it.
Absolutely, and I'm very pleased that you used the term dependent, because there is a physical dependency. And in our society now, most times when people hear the word addict, they only think about the illegal use and component. But it is a physical dependency, whether you're doing it illegally or if it's a prescription drug. And in my earlier days of nursing, I might be dating myself, but the opioids used to be the drug of choice for terminal cancer patients and patients who were being treated palliatively just for comfort. There was no possibility that anything else was going to happen.
Right.
But now they're ordering the opioids for many things. Just like you said,
right.
I'm in a car accident, severe headaches, all kinds of things. So it's very important for parents and their household to know that sometimes when they're getting these medications, not only is it very important for them, but it's also very important for their family in terms of safety.
Exactly.
So let's talk about what, I mean, from the street perspective, we know that the crack cocaine and all of those things are illegal opioids. Even the methadone that they use for treatment is an opioid.
Mm-hmm.
But there are some other drugs that patients are given in hospital and maybe as a part of their treatment management program that they might not think of as opioids. So what are some common drugs or common names of drugs that doctors are using for painkillers that are opioids?
Okay, so common ones I see are OxyContin, which is oxycodone, as well as Percocet, which is also oxycodone, but in combination with acetaminophen.
Right.
And people actually sell those medications. I've had a customer when I first became a pharmacist who came in and said, "Hey, Michelle, do you have the 512? And I'm like, "Huh?" He said, "Excuse me?" And so he said, "The 512 Percocets."
Mm-hmm.
So I said, "No, sir, we don't." And then I realized once I was filling a generic Percocet prescription that it's the imprint on the tablet
that he was
wanted that specific brand of generic Percocet.
Oh, wow.
So it kind of blew my mind. But
absolutely. And, and since you said that, I think it is also worth noting for moms and dads with children that while we may be calling them by their pharmaceutical names, there are also street names for many of these opioids.
Right.
Correct?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. When we are talking about drugs that are frequently misused, and I would like to say this too on behalf or speaking for patients, many people who become dependent are, that is not a willful act. I'm just taking these drugs just because they make me feel good or whatever. But then when we talk about the illegal use, we are talking about people who are using them for reasons other than their prescribed purpose. So as a pharmacist, what is your take on the crisis right now for pharmacists? You work in, not in hospital, but in a community-based institution. What is your take on your concerns and things that you know that you have to be always on your P's and Q's about in relations to this opioid crisis?
So it really is an issue, a crisis.
Mm-hmm.
I still see, even with all the regulations in place to control the dispensing of opioids,
mm-hmm.
doctors still prescribe them in large quantity to patients with chronic pain.
Right.
And it doesn't seem like it's gonna change. They don't try to taper the dose down. They don't try to offer physical therapy or anything. It's every month they're getting their OxyContin 30-day supply or their Percocet 30-day supply in very large quantities. And so with that, I don't know if people are taking it all or if they're kind of piling it in their homes.
Stockpiling it.
And when you stockpile it in your home, that is when you have family members that can get to it. They can abuse it or use it and cause accidental overdose, or they also can take it and sell it or exchange it. Mm-hmm. Especially teenagers, they'll take this oxycodone and exchange it for an Adderall, which mm-hmm. is an attention deficit medication. Mm-hmm. So it's very concerning that you still see doctors prescribing these medications in those large quantities.
Absolutely. And you mentioned a couple of terms that I would like to go back and talk about. You mentioned controlled substances. Mm-hmm. And in hospital for us, it was a little bit better because anytime we dispensed controlled substances, we had to put the patient's name, the number we gave them, and then subtract that number from our regular stock number or whatever we'd been dispensed. But a controlled substance, and this is, I guess, the government's way of, or the government's way of trying to keep tabs on these substances, are any substances that they feel an individual may become addicted to or could use for illicit purposes. And so anytime you hear of controlled substances, and sometimes it may be even some of the anti-anxiety drugs and some of the other things, they are being monitored, and there is some responsibility on the part of the prescriber.
Yes.
And that's why, just knowing, and I, as I shared my story with you, I had a spinal fusion. And my prescriber gave me a 90-day supply on the day that I was leaving the hospital. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm a nurse, and I did know that it was an opioid of oxycodone. Mm-hmm. But I think about the problems it would have been for some mom or someone who was not as medically competent about the pharmaceutical part of the medication they were giving me, of what that could have done for them and the risk that it could put families. So when we're talking about teenagers specifically, how do you think family members, or what do you think family members should do to safeguard their medications?
Okay. So when it comes to controlled substances, people should actually keep it in a locked cabinet mm-hmm. or a safe. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have a locked cabinet or a safe, you should hide it. It should not be in plain sight in your medicine cabinet where anyone can get to it and misuse it. Mm-hmm. You can put it in a shoebox in the back of your closet. Just definitely keep it out of plain sight.
Right. And you know, I know sometimes when I've gone to the homes of people who are on medications, prescriptions of any kind, mm-hmm. you can see their medication bottles just lined up on the dining room table,
right.
on the break front, or mm-hmm. anything like that. That really is a no-no. We should be a lot more careful
right.
with our medications. And I have a very strong concern about the community, but more specifically our adolescents. Now, they're going through a really bad time anyway. And when I think about some of the things that parents need to be aware of when they have prescription medications or alcohol mm-hmm. in the home and they have adolescents, I cannot stress enough how important it is for parents to talk to their children about their medications.
Yes.
But they should be we should be talking to all patients about their medications. So as a pharmacist and your service to medication education or whatever, what are mm-hmm. some of the things that you see happening now in the community, especially with the community-based providers?
In
relations to education about medication, safeguarding, discarding, anything like that.
Okay, so what I've seen is a lot of prescribers, they actually talk about side effects with medications with their patients. Mm-hmm. And then when they come to the pharmacy, we actually reiterate those, the side effects. We definitely let them know if there are drug interactions with something that they're currently taking to educate them and make them aware of signs and symptoms that could occur. Mm-hmm. And we also say, you know, the safety perspective. Keep your medications out of reach of small children as well as adolescents to prevent accidental overdose or death.
Right. And even for people who are taking them legally and being followed by a healthcare provider, there is an accumulative effect with some of these drugs. And anytime, even though I'm taking them the way the doctor prescribed and I'm doing everything the doctor said do, if it comes to a point where my body is not metabolizing and detoxifying and excreting these drugs, I could still get into a problem with overdose, correct?
You can. Another thing to know with pain relievers or any medication, on your label, it does say as needed. So if you're not in pain or if you don't feel anxious or you can fall asleep on your own, you don't need to take the medication.
Right, right. And that leads to another discussion that we had. Does every pain require an opioid?
It doesn't.
It does not?
It doesn't. It doesn't have to be your first choice or your first line therapy. That's why it's important to know exactly what your diagnosis is or what type of pain you have. Because if it's a problem with your nerves, then maybe a different class of medication would handle that pain better.
Right. So not every pain is needs to be treated with opioids. And I would also venture to say that there are some pains that can have some kind of auxiliary or adjunct therapies. They may work equally as well.
Exactly.
Right. And many people don't know that we have our own internal pain medication system with the endorphins. I mean, if you're doing things and exercising and trying to manage your pain, your brain will kick in and try to give you a little bit of pain relief without first resorting to painful chemicals.
Right. Physical therapy is really a good, something good to do that doesn't require medication. When I was in pharmacy school, I took a class. It was water aerobics.
Absolutely.
And everyone in the class, they either had fibromyalgia or some type of back pain or muscular discomfort, and they all said that that was really beneficial.
Right. And again, I go back to one of the things that's in the literature that's being put out now by the Health and Human Services, and that is the fact in terms of potentiality for addiction or dependency, any time that you take an opioid for 3 days or more, after you start going beyond that, there is this potential for some kind of your body to start needing and wanting that drug. And for each time you have an opioid prescription renewed, then the potential goes higher.
Definitely.
And so it says to us that sometimes while I know we want to be pain-free, sometimes we might need to rely on our internal painkillers and some other kind of adjunct alternative therapies to help us relieve some of those pain. Eating heat and cold and positioning. There are lots of things we can do except to take these chemicals.
Yes, there are.
And so when you are as a pharmacist and you're looking at talking with patients and educating patients about what the drug is supposed to do, you all, as a pharmacist, as a discipline, address the kinds of things that they shouldn't do. And what would be your number one warning about opioids and alcohol?
They do not mix.
Never, never.
They do not mix. Do not take your OxyContin with a beer.
Right.
And I do I've seen a prescription where the doctor actually writes, take one pill with non-alcoholic fluids to let people know that that's not a good thing.
Right.
Because the combination can actually be fatal.
Absolutely. And even for some of the anti-anxiety drugs or the muscle relaxants, you just should not mix medications.
Exactly.
It's just not safe. And I am particularly concerned about people who accidentally become dependent. And that is the mom who knows she has to go to work. And I have this terrible pain in my back or my leg or my head, and I've got to continue to keep this medicine on tap. And then there's another very innocent population that gets addicted through no will of their own, and that's our babies, our children. What would you say to pregnant women who are using opioids?
I would say it's very important to think not only of yourself, but of your unborn child, because mm-hmm. everything that you ingest goes to that baby. Mm-hmm. And so if you're dependent on painkillers, your child is going to come into this world addicted to painkillers, and they don't have the immune system to fight
right.
the way you do right. as an adult.
Right. Everything we take, everything we do, we eat, just like we provide them nourishment and oxygen and everything, all of the untoward and undesirable things that we do with our bodies and put into our bodies mm-hmm. are also, and nothing is more heartbreaking than seeing a little bitty baby come into the world in withdrawals.
Right.
Very painful.
Yeah.
Now, the one thing that has happened, though, in terms of what the government is doing is that they have now started to focus on prevention and treatment. The major antidote now, you shared something with me that I think all of our viewers should know. Naloxone?
Yes, naloxone is marketed as Narcan, and that is actually what you call an opioid antagonist. So it's going to reverse any effects that an opioid may have. So
right.
if someone is overdosing on an opioid, you
right.
can give them the naloxone and it will reverse those effects.
Right. It's so dramatic the way that it does it. It happens pretty spontaneously, correct?
It does.
And you are saying now that as far as you know in Virginia.
In Virginia, the Commonwealth of Virginia, the health department, they provided a standing order, which is a prescription that allows pharmacists to dispense naloxone without a prescription.
Without a prescription.
So anyone can actually come to the counter and say, hey, can I have naloxone so mm-hmm. I can have it on hand just in case.
As an emergency. And moms and dads, I hate to raise up red flags and scare tactics, but if we don't know what our kids are doing, and if they're coming home looking strange, acting strange, locking you out of their room, their color, they're not worried about how they look, they're not going to school and doing the things that they're supposed to do, and you haven't had a good conversation with them, it would be a good idea to be safe rather than sorry for walking into that kid's room one day and finding them cold and clammy, unresponsive, not able to get a pulse, not breathing very well, to have something that you can do right away then while you're calling 911. And that's the first thing you should do rather than watch that child slip away from you. Overdose is really a big problem. So talk to your children first. Be safe in your practices if you are being prescribed those drugs, but know the signs of an opioid overdose, not only just for the children, but for yourself. And the other thing that I'd like to say is while it does make people feel good, it has some other very detrimental effects on other parts of your body.
Correct.
So what are some of the side effects those opioids have on your body? I know it affects respiration. And
It does, and that can cause the death. It'll slow your breathing
down. Slow your breathing down.
But it can also make you nauseous. It can cause constipation.
Constipation big time.
And it can also cause drowsiness.
Right.
So you're impaired. So
right.
you don't want to go driving
Absolutely.
Or operating any heavy machinery if you are taking opioids.
Right. And as a pharmacist and an educator and one who knows about the drug, I'm going to give you the opportunity to have the last words with our audience, our viewing audience. But just remember in your households to be safe. but always that an opioid overdose does not happen, can happen sometimes without just one dose. It could be an accumulative effect. It can happen accidentally. I took my medicine this morning, but I forgot, so I'm taking another dose. Mm-hmm. It can happen accidentally as well. So leave with our viewers some helpful thoughts about prevention and about discarding.
Okay, so if you have to take an opioid medication, just remember you don't have to take it if you don't have pain. Only take it if you need it. And once you have this medication in your home, make sure you keep it in a locked cabinet or safe. If you don't have a locked cabinet or safe, hide it. Don't put it in your medicine cabinet so everyone can have access to it. If you do have medication left over, you want to, they have a drug take-back program.
Yes.
You can actually go online and type in drug take-back program, and it'll give you a list of places you can dispose of it.
Right.
If you don't have that access, you can actually dump them into kitty litter.
Yes.
And dispose of it that way.
Or ammonia or some other things that...
Right, or even coffee grounds.
A coffee grounds.
You can put it in that and dispose of it that way. You definitely want to make sure you take all your personal information off the bottles. You can scratch it out, but make sure when you hold it up, you still can't see your information on there. And then the actual bottle can be recycled.
Thank you so much. And in addition to that, Dr. Webster, Pearson will say, don't flush it down the toilet.
No.
Thank you so much, Dr. Harbour, for being our guest on Health Matters today. If you would like more information about opioids, please visit the website of the Department of Health and Human Services at www.hhs.gov/opioids. I'm Dr. C. Webster Pearson. Thank you for watching. Please join me next time, and remember always, your health matters.